Morning, everyone. Well, thank you for joining us in worship today. I hope everyone is having a wonderful 4th of July and Independence Day weekend. So you'll see a couple of songs in our service that and prayers and things like that that have to do with asking God to bless our nation, to help us preserve and protect our cherished liberties, and then give guidance and wisdom and blessing and to our national leaders. Also, we will talk in our service today about being a courageous witness for Christ, even in the face of persecution and unpopularity. Now more than ever, we need that encouragement to be bold witnesses. So that'll be a little bit about our service today. We have a baptism in the second service, but in this first service today, we'll still tie our confession of sins into baptism. That's a strong teaching in Scripture that every day, through contrition and repentance and faith in Christ, we our old Adam is drowned in baptism, and we're raised with the risen Christ to live a new life. Unfortunately, we can't sing, That announcement came like late Wednesday or Thursday night. Fortunately, we're blessed with some wonderful soloists, and we're going to be able to listen to some beautiful songs this morning. I think that's about it. Again, pay attention to the screen. Our first hymn is called Blessed Are They.
Blessed are they, full of
We continue with the confession of sins and absolution according to the order of service for holy baptism. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you. Our Savior Jesus Christ commanded baptism when he said, "Go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit." All of us are born into this world with a deep need for baptism. From our parents, we inherit a sinful nature. We are without true fear of God and true faith in God and are condemned to eternal death. But Jesus took away our sin by giving his life on the cross. At our baptism, he clothes us with the robe of his righteousness and gives us a new life. Our sinful nature need not control us any longer. We recall what baptism means for our daily lives as together we speak these words. Baptism means that the sinful nature in us should be drowned by daily sorrow and repentance, and that all its evil deeds and desires be put to death. It also means that a new person should daily arise to live before God in righteousness and purity forever. As baptized children of God, we confess our sins. Holy and merciful Father, I confess that I am by nature sinful and that I have disobeyed you in my thoughts, words, and actions. I have done what is evil and failed to do what is good. For this, I deserve your punishment both now and in eternity. But I am truly sorry for my sins, and trusting in my Savior Jesus Christ, I pray. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. God, our Heavenly Father, has been merciful to us and has given his only Son to be the atoning sacrifice for our sins. Therefore, as a called servant of Christ and by his authority, I forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. The first of our scripture lessons for today, which is the fifth Sunday in the season of Pentecost, is from Jeremiah chapter 20, beginning at verse 7. Even in the face of persecution, the prophet Jeremiah continues to courageously confess the name of God. You deceived me, Lord, and I was deceived. You overpowered me and prevailed. I am ridiculed all day long. Everyone mocks me. Whenever I speak, I cry out, proclaiming violence and destruction. So the word of the Lord has brought me insult and reproach all day long. But if I say, I will not mention his word or speak any more in his name, his word is in my heart like a fire. A fire shut up in my bones. I am weary of holding it in. Indeed, I cannot. I hear many whispering, terror on every side. Denounce him, let's denounce him. All my friends are waiting for me to slip, saying, perhaps he will be deceived. Then we will prevail over him and take our revenge on him. But the Lord is with me like a mighty warrior, so my persecutors will stumble and not prevail. They will fail and be thoroughly disgraced. Their dishonor will never be forgotten. Lord Almighty, you who examine the righteous and probe the heart and mind, let me see your vengeance on them, for to you I have committed my cause. Give praise to the Lord. He rescues the life of the needy from the hands of the wicked. This is the word of the Lord. Our second reading is from Acts chapter 23. The Apostle Paul here testifies courageously before the Jewish leadership. Paul looked straight at the Sanhedrin and said, "My brothers, I have fulfilled my duty to God in all good conscience to this day." At this, the high priest Ananias ordered those standing near Paul to strike him on the mouth. Then Paul said to him, "God will strike you, you whitewashed wall. You sit there to judge me according to the law, yet You yourself violate the law by commanding that I be struck. Those who were standing near Paul said, How dare you insult God's high priest? Paul replied, Brothers, I did not realize that he was the high priest, for it is written, Do not speak evil about the ruler of your people. Then Paul, knowing that some of them were Sadducees and others Pharisees, called out in the Sanhedrin, My brothers, I am a Pharisee, descended from Pharisees. I stand on trial because of the hope and the resurrection of the dead. When he said this, a dispute broke out between the Pharisees and the Sadducees, and the assembly was divided. The Sadducees say that there is no resurrection, and that there are neither angels nor spirits, but the Pharisees believe all these things. There was a great uproar, and some of the teachers of the law who were Pharisees stood up and argued vigorously. We find nothing wrong with this man, they said. What if a spirit or an angel has spoken to him? The dispute became so violent that the commander was afraid Paul would be torn to pieces by them. He ordered the troops to go down and take him away from them by force and bring him into the barracks. The following night, the Lord stood near Paul and said, Take courage. As you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome. This too is the word of our Lord. And now we confess our Christian faith according to the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Our next hymn is, O Christ Who Called the Twelve.
O Christ Who Called the Twelve to rise and follow you, forsaking to hear your call.
I'm really happy to be here this morning to actually speak to faces rather than to speak to a camera, first time since the beginning of March. We're going to be looking at the gospel for today from Matthew, the 10th chapter, beginning with verse 24. I'll read those verses. These are the words of Jesus. The student is not above the teacher, nor a servant above his master. It is enough for students to be like their teachers and servants like their masters. If the head of the house has been called Beelzebul, how much more the members of his household? So do not be afraid of them, for there's nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. What I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. Do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather, be afraid of the one who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground outside your Father's care. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So, don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. Whoever confesses me before others, I will also confess before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will deny before my Father in heaven. This is the gospel of Christ. It was about 60 years ago, actually 1961, in post-World War II East Germany, which was under the control of the atheistic Soviet Union at the time. And the Soviets were bent on destroying all remnants of Christianity. And they focused their attention primarily on young people. And one of the ways they did this was by denying higher education to anyone who refused to adhere to the politically correct views. There was a teenager, he's 15 years old. His name was Peter Gottfried. He lived there in East Germany. His father was a Lutheran pastor. Peter was very talented musically. He wanted to go on to a music conservatory. A part of the application process consisted in filling out a form that had seven questions on it. Question seven was the challenging one. Peter had to name the most important influence in his life. I knew that if he had been at all honest, or would be at all honest, he would have to say, that's been my father. And with that, of course, he would have been confessing that he was a Christian. And with that, his opportunity for higher education would have flown out the window. So what should Peter Gottfried do? What would you and I have done under that situation? There's no doubt what Jesus would have wanted us to do. We just read this before when Jesus says, whoever confesses me before others, I will confess before my Father in heaven. But whoever denies me before others, I will deny before my Father in heaven. So in these words, Jesus is calling us, isn't he, to a bold, courageous confession of his name. Jesus first spoke these words to the 12 apostles. And he spoke them right before he was about to send them out on their first solo mission trip. Last Sunday's gospel started to tell us a little bit about that. But before Jesus sent them out, he gave to his apostles a pretty lengthy list of instructions. All 42 verses of Matthew chapter 10 are these pre-mission trip instructions of Jesus. Our gospel is just a little portion, of that. And Jesus told them where to go. He told them what to say. He told them how to respond if people accepted their message. He told them how to respond if people rejected their message. And he also told them that they should expect opposition. We're going to come back to that just a little bit later on. But I think first, the first thing we really need to do is find an answer to the question, why? Why? Why would the 12 want to go out from the safety of walking with Jesus to confess his name to others? Why would people like you and me desire to do that? There's a very simple answer for that we find in the book of Acts, fourth chapter of Acts. Peter and John have just been tossed into prison because they had been preaching about the resurrection of Jesus. And given an opportunity to defend themselves before the highest council of the Jews, the Sanhedrin, they decided to go on the offensive instead. They said, why did we do it? Here's what Peter said on behalf of himself and John. Salvation is found in no one else. For, he says, there is no other name than the name of Jesus under heaven given to mankind by which we must be saved. Now, what was the response of the council to what Peter said? This is in Acts 4. When they saw the courage of Peter and John and realized that they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished. And now here come the key words. And they took note of them that these men had been with Jesus. With Jesus. So it was with all of the apostles that Jesus was about to send out on their first mission trip. They had been with Jesus. And that had been a life-changing experience for them. They would have heard Jesus in a Sermon on the Mount say, unless your righteousness exceeds or surpasses that of the Pharisees and the teachings of the law, you will certainly not enter the kingdom of God. And that would have astonished the 12, because in their mind there was no one who was more righteous and godly than the Pharisees and the teachers of the law. But Jesus meant what he said. In fact, in the very same Sermon on the Mount, he said, be perfect, even as your Father in heaven is perfect. The apostles knew that even if their righteousness, their godliness, surpassed that of the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, which it hadn't in their mind, they certainly hadn't been perfect. Jesus wanted them to know that they were sinners, and that because of their lack of perfection, they had merited not life, but death. Not heaven, but hell. That was some really bad news for them to hear. But Jesus also had some good news for them. Because what Jesus had told Nicodemus by night, he certainly also would have told the 12 by day. God so loved the world, you know the words, that he gave his one and only Son, that he gave me, Jesus says, that whoever believes in me will not perish, but have eternal life. That's the men who now went out to confess the name of Jesus, who've been with Jesus, who had come to know the sad truth about themselves, but the glad truth about Jesus, their Savior. And isn't that even true today? Confessing the name of Christ begins with being with Jesus. And that means knowing the truth about ourselves. The bad news that we have all sinned and we've fallen short of the glory of God. But the good news that Jesus came into the world to save sinners, even the chief of sinners. And he did that for the whole world. And if he did it for the whole world, that answers the why. Why do we want to go out? That's the way it is for those who are with Jesus. That's the way it is for those who are basking in the sunshine of his love and are experiencing joy and peace and hope. That's the way it was with the prophet Jeremiah, where we heard in today's first reading, who said, "If I say I will not mention his," that is God's word, or speak any more in his name, his word, he says, is in my heart like a fire shut it up in my bones. I'm weary of holding it in. Indeed, he says, I cannot. And that's the way it was with Christ's apostle Paul, who writing to the Corinthians says, I am compelled. And here's not talking about an exterior compulsion, but an inner compulsion. I am compelled to preach, to confess the name of Jesus. Woe to me if I do not preach the gospel. And so it is with us. For the Christian who walks with Jesus, the only must about confessing the name of Jesus is the must that comes from inside of us. From hearts that, along with the apostles, along with Jeremiah, just can't hold it in. Who have to tell others, confess what we have seen and heard. It's not always going to be easy to do that. I mentioned before, you read Matthew 10, and you can read about what the opposition that Jesus said that his apostles would face. It's not always going to be easy to do this. Sometimes opposition can take physical form. Peter and John were thrown into prison. Even death. And that's happening in parts of the world, even yet today. It's one of the things that we thank our gracious God for on this 4th of July weekend. There are many things in our country, many things about our government that we may not like, but we all like, and we thank God for the fact that we still have the freedom to worship our God according to the dictates of our conscience. But it doesn't mean we won't face opposition. More likely in the form of ridicule and mockery for what we believe. Like the Apostle Paul experienced when he was in Athens and he told the wise men there about the resurrection of Jesus and found that they laughed at him. As the end draws near, the difference between those who walk with Jesus and those who walk in opposition to Jesus will become more and more pronounced. And we're living in those times right now. So, says Jesus, don't be surprised at opposition. And that's where the words of today's gospel kick in when he says, the student is not above his teacher, the teacher is Jesus, nor a servant above his master. If the head of the house, Jesus is talking about himself, has been called Beelzebub, Satan himself, how much more the members of his household? If the world hates me, says Jesus, you can expect the very same treatment. Don't be surprised, Jesus says. If you stand up for the truth, to be laughed at. But then Jesus adds a second don't. Not just don't be surprised, but he says, don't be afraid. He says, do not be afraid of them, that is, those who oppose the gospel. He says, for there's nothing concealed that will not be disclosed, or hidden that will not be made known. You see what Jesus is saying here? He's assuring us, Christians, that we're on the winning side. He's assuring us that the voice of the gospel will never be silenced. Satan may be able to silence a particular messenger of the gospel, but he will never be able to muzzle the message. We see a dramatic example of that again in the book of Acts, the end of chapter 7, the story of Stephen, the first martyr, gave his life for boldly confessing the name of Christ. And we're told after that happened, a great persecution broke out in the church or throughout Jerusalem. And the Christians actually had to flee the city of Jerusalem. And Satan must have been laughing with glee. He'd shut the mouth of the gospel, but it didn't work that way. Beginning of Acts chapter 8, we're told those who were scattered preached, proclaimed the word wherever they went. And that's what gave rise to the saying, the blood of the martyrs is the seed of the church. Don't be afraid. Satan cannot silence the gospel. And therefore, says Jesus, what I tell you in the dark, speak in the daylight. What is whispered in your ear, proclaim from the roofs. So what you hear within the safe confines of these four walls, don't keep it there. Bring it out to the rooftops. Courageously confess my name, says Jesus. And he says, and do not be afraid of those who kill the body but cannot kill the soul. Rather be afraid of those who can destroy both soul and body in hell. Now, being martyred for one's faith, that's no minor matter. No one wants to lose his or her life. But you realize the very most that Satan could ever do to us is take our physical life. He can't rob us of our real life. Can't rob us of heaven. I think of Martin Luther in his hymn, the battle hymn of the Reformation. I learned the words in our old Lutheran hymnal, stanza 4, and take they our life, goods, fame, child, or wife, let these all be gone, they yet have nothing won. The kingdom ours remaineth. Jesus goes on. Are not two sparrows sold for a penny? Yet not one of them will fall to the ground apart from the will of your Father. And even the very hairs of your head are all numbered. So don't be afraid. You are worth more than many sparrows. He who watches over the sparrows, the least of God's creation, is certainly going to watch over you and me, the crown of his creation, whom he loves so much that he sent his Son into the world to suffer and die for us. Go back to Peter Gottfried, for a moment. What should he do? His future, it hung in the balance. Should he forfeit his future or should he deny his Savior? He chose not to deny him. And let the chips fall where they may. It was the right decision, wasn't it? And I pray if I had ever would ever be in a situation like that, that I would do the same thing, and I'm sure you pray the very same thing. But what if in a moment of weakness we wouldn't do that? What if we deny rather than confess? You're well acquainted with another Peter. The Peter that we talked about at the beginning of the sermon, who boldly confessed their salvation in no other name. But go back a few months, and that it's the same Peter who is there in the courtyard of the high priest while Jesus is on trial, and he has this marvelous opportunity to courageously confess the name of Jesus, and what does he do? You know. Threefold denial. But Jesus forgave his repentant disciple. And he restored him as an apostle. We have a loving God who does not want us to spend our lives fearing that we might fail him in the future. We have a merciful God who does not want us to fret over the fact that we may have failed him in the past. We have a forgiving God, forgives all our sins, be they many, be they big. And that brings us back to the why. Won't this fact that we have this loving, forgiving God, won't that be that which propels us to desire to be in and remain in the ranks of those who will courageously confess the name of Christ and be willing to suffer anything, even death, rather than to deny him? Amen. And now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding guard and keep your hearts and minds through faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. At this point, normally there would be an offering that is gathered, and as you know, we can express our love for our Savior through our offering, and the plates you can find on any of the three exits going out of the church. And let us bow our heads in prayer. Almighty God, all we have and enjoy is a gift from your gracious hand. On this Independence Day weekend, we thank you especially for our nation and its people. You have enriched us with the bounties of farm and factory, the beauty of forest and mountain, and the marvels of medicine and science. We thank you for enabling us to worship you in freedom and to serve you without fear. Look with favor upon our nation in these difficult days. Preserve our precious liberties. Enable our leaders to govern with wisdom, honesty, courage, and justice. Protect those who serve in the armed forces and those who maintain peace and safety in our communities. And give us willingness to obey our nation's laws and to work for the common good. Keep our financial institutions secure and our economy strong. Guard us from the calamities of nature and deliver us from the ravages of disease and epidemic. Teach us not to worry, but to cast all our anxieties on you. Strengthen the homes of our nation. By your Spirit, lead husbands and wives to love each other, parents to nurture their children, young adults to assume responsibility, and children to show respect. Hear our prayer for Jesus' sake. Amen. And in his name, we also join together to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Our next hymn, God Bless Our Native Land.
Going to get ready to distribute the Lord's Supper once again, and if you remember from last time, you'll be ushered kind of to the west side of church. You'll be ushered, you can come up either in a group of a family or a couple or an individual, so space yourselves out a little bit, and come right up through here, and you'll receive the bread and a word of blessing, and then just kind of keep continuously flowing this way for the individual cup of wine to dispose in those baskets, and then come right around over on the east side. So, Chuck, if you could grab this chair right here, and I think we'll be ready to go. I'll continue with the words of institution. Our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, on the night that he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Then he took the cup, gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. May this true body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ strengthen and keep you in the true faith until life everlasting. Your sins are forgiven. Go in peace. We continue with the closing blessing. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you peace. Amen. We'll listen to the closing hymn, Go My Children with My Blessing.
My children, with my blessing.
Okay, well, thank you again so much for joining us in worship today. God's blessings on the rest of your weekend. Stay away from the beach. There's too many people from other counties down at our beach. But I hope you have a safe and wonderful Fourth. Got a couple things coming up, of course. The More Than Conquerors sermon series actually begins this coming week. Vicar will tell you more about that next Sunday. Vicar's at what used to be known as Gethsemane Lutheran, our Wells Church in West Los Angeles. Now it's Hope Lutheran, and good for him that he's got a different experience at a different church. I think that's an important part of his vicar year as well. But we got some vicars coming and going and teachers coming and going. We just said farewell to Adam and Alyssa, and then you see that Samantha Kicker, I believe is how she pronounces that. At our voters meeting last Sunday, the budget was approved to continue with the school through grades 5, so that meant we needed a new grades 3 through 5 teacher. And one way to make that happen quickly is to ask Martin Luther College to send us a student who's almost done with their classes. So Samantha Kicker was called and accepted that. She's from Phoenix. She'll be moving over here on Wednesday. I think we've got an apartment lined up for her in the same area where Adam and Alyssa lived and the Vickers live. And we're looking forward to welcoming her, and you'll get to know her. We'll probably have her installation a little bit later in the summer. And Vicar Balgi's last Sunday is the 2nd, and soon there's a planning meeting for sort of a farewell for him, August 2nd, and then a new vicar welcome on August 9th. So a lot to keep track of, but we'll keep you posted. Yeah? What? Oh, she wants to know what happened with that Peter Guthrie who made that.
Oh, okay. What happened was he didn't know what was going to happen, but eventually he was able to come over to the United States.
Oh?
From behind the curtain and get over to the United States.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, that's great.
Thank you.
Yeah. Yeah. Epilogue. Sometimes we need an epilogue. All right. You'll be ushered out. We'll see you outside under the UV rays and can chat a little bit more.